and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So, there's a number of people who are speaking, and they make videos and they put them on Facebook, and they're motivational movies and videos and those sorts of things. And there's one, he's a small business guru of some sort. And he's got a phrase which is really interesting. He says, everyone's an addict. Everyone's addicted to something. Some of us are addicted to things that we shouldn't be, that aren't quite socially acceptable, like drugs. Some people are addicted to drugs, and that's not a good thing. But some people are addicted to work. And they get to work at 7 o'clock in the morning, and they don't leave till 7 o'clock at night, and they think that makes them, that gives them their value. Some of us are addicted to social media, and people wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning to check their phones to see if anyone has liked their last Instagram post. I don't. Nothing wakes me up at 2 o'clock in the morning. A lot of us are addicted to happy. We're addicted to this idea that we should be happy all the time. There are parents who go, I don't care what my child does as long as they are happy. You've heard that? Hear it quite often. When you're a teacher, you hear it regularly. I don't care what my child does, as long as they're happy. That's fine, Just put them in front of Teletubbies, and when they're 2, and they'll never mature. And they'll be watching Teletubbies when they're 45, and they'll still be happy. And I don't have a problem with Teletubbies for 2-year-olds. Teletubbies for 30-year-olds is a problem. There's a modern storyteller and philosopher who makes movies. His name's Tim Burton. And he made the movie Alice in Wonderland. And if you've ever watched it, it is really quite insightful and quite interesting. And the story is Alice basically going from being sort of a milksop. She's a bit of a indecisive, but she doesn't have much strength of character. And she goes through this adventure which refines and purifies her, and in the end she slays the Jabberwocky. And she comes back to reality. And she decides she's not going to get married to the person that society says she shouldn't be married to. And she says something really interesting to her mum. She says, don't worry. She doesn't say, I'll be happy. She says, I will do something useful with my life. It's a very different approach to the I don't care what they do as long as they are happy. So in the gospel, Jesus is telling the story. It does connect. In the gospel, Jesus is telling the story. He says there is a farmer, and he's sown good seed, and someone else sows bad seed, and they grow. And the first thing to be aware of is the servants come and they say, there seems to be a mix-up here. Should we send people in to pull out the weeds? Now, I'm told that if you're a farmer in this part of the world, and the weeds that are referenced are some sort, and they've got like this root map, and it actually ties itself into the roots of the wheat. I don't know. But I do think it's interesting that the owner says no. Because in pulling out the weeds, you might pull out the good stuff. The important thing to recognize is that sometimes, unless you really are deeply insightful and trained in the difference between weeds and wheat when they're very young, it's hard to tell the difference. And those parents who only care about the happiness of their children, that's not really what they mean, I suspect. What they want is they want their kids to be satisfied with their life, to do something of value and meaning, But they use the word happiness. Happiness is a drug, and drugs wear off, and all you do is you start looking for the next high. Value and meaning is not a drug, but it continues to feed. So the thing is, it's hard to tell the difference as they grow. But when they've grown, which one does the farmer want? Which one is he going to take and harvest and put in the storehouse? It's the wheat, not the weeds. Why? Why would a farmer want wheat and not weeds? Because the wheat is useful. The wheat contributes something. It contributes food. Last week we had the story of the four soils. One basket of wheat seeds, 10 baskets of wheat is a good crop. Got to keep one to be planted next. And the other 9 baskets are going to feed people. It is useful. It is of value. The weeds, on the other hand, have no value. They are not useful. So where does that leave us? It leaves us with a really worrying question, which is, how useful are we in the world? See, because if we're just in here, we might as well be the weeds. If you can't tell the difference between us and those who are just consumers of the world who have no value, then what's the point? Christ calls us to be people who are useful in the world. And the example of usefulness here is something that feeds others. One of the things that worries me in the media is how often Christians are seen as being anti-everything. You know, I'm sure you can think of some examples. Historically, we've been pretty anti-science. Some denominations. I love it, but anyway, because I'm a geek. We've been anti-changes in our society. We've been anti a lot of things. And I wish that what Christians were known for in society was being those people that fed others more. We should be making a ruckus in our society when there are people who are hungry and are not fed. Because that's useful. We should be, and we do this in our church with Solomon's, and I'm really grateful for that. As Christians, we should be people who, when someone is cold and has no clothing, makes a plan and finds them some clothing. That is useful. That's being the wheat. That's responding to God through loving service to the world. That's what we are called to do and to be. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen.